Just as tensions were reaching an all-time high, the band was touched by a heart-wrenching encounter with a devoted fan. In October 84, the mother of 16-year-old Kenny Sekulik wrote to the group on her son's behalf. Kenny was losing his battle with cystic fibrosis, and his last wish was to meet his idols. Journey immediately flew to his bedside in a Cleveland hospital.
Here's this little kid, just struggling for every breath he could, and we were doing everything in our power not to break down and bawl, you know, in front of him.
The band brought a Walkman loaded with a demo of a new song, Only the Young. Kenny was the first person outside the band to hear what would become a top 10 hit.
Played it for him, and that was rough. That was really rough because he was in heaven. You know, he really was in heaven.
Still to this day, I can always see his face, you know, and I can see his pleasure of hearing that song. I mean, he just melted into his bed. And that song will always be his song.
Less than a day after meeting his heroes, Kenny passed away. But in the space of a few hours, he left an impression that would last a lifetime.
That's the worst thing I've ever seen. It's just not fair, you know, for kids to live with that kind of pain. It's just not fair. Sorry.
It changed my outlook on life. It makes you realize that the things that you were making a big deal out of maybe were not so big.
Next, Journey rediscovers the joy.
We sat around the piano and we wrote 12 songs, you know, like in 2 weeks.
And later, Steve Perry's comeback is cut short.
All of a sudden, I started having acute pain in my left side, and I didn't think I was going to make it off the mountain.
When Behind the Music continues.
They call a letter in before I begin. Ooh, let's hop.
In the fall of 1984, Steve Perry's solo album, Street Talk, was roaring out of radios from coast to coast. But just as Foolish Heart became the record's second top 20 hit, Steve received devastating news. His mother was stricken with a rare neurological disorder.
It was a slow thing, and it was painful because I had watched her life kind of be slowly robbed from her.
Steve's mother, Mary, had been the one who convinced him to give Journey a try to begin with. And now, with her time so close to an end, Perry again questioned the direction of his own life.
I really didn't want to do another Journey record, to be honest with you, because she was so sick. I kind of wanted to stay with her.
Once again, Mary convinced her son to join Journey. But after his solo success, Steve Perry was more determined than ever to control the band's direction.
Journey needed to take a musical direction, take a few chances, and do some different material. It wasn't my solo material, and it wasn't Journey's old material. It was kind of its own stuff.
Perry says that after several studio sessions, the band wasn't capturing the sound he was looking for. So with the agreement of Neil Schon and Jonathan Cain, longtime bassist Ross Valerie and drummer Steve Smith were fired.
It came to us at the meeting that he hates Ross Valerie and Steve Smith. It's like, wait a minute, what did I do here?
I'll be all right.
Journey moved on as a trio, backed by studio musicians.
It was Steve's baby, so he was in charge. He picked the musicians, the songs. He didn't have to be democratic.
Having had those circumstances in front of me today, knowing what I know now, I wouldn't have done it. It seemed like a good idea at the time. I was one of those situations when music just dictated again, and boy, I had to have it.
The band may have been pared down, but Perry's vocals and Neil Schon's guitar licks were as potent as ever. Released in early 86, Raised on Radio quickly gave birth to four more top 10 tunes, including the smash Be Good to Yourself. But hits were no longer bringing happiness to Steve Perry. He'd broken up with girlfriend Sherry Swafford. Then he got word his mother was nearing the end. Steve rushed to her bedside.
I told her that if she wanted to go, it was okay because she'd been shackled by her body for years. And I just kept saying that and stroking her forehead, and she passed.
Mary died as Steve held her in his arms. For all of his fame, Steve suddenly felt very alone.
I felt like I re-entered the Earth's atmosphere without heat tiles on my face. I was burning on the way in, okay? It was very, very uncomfortable because I realized how much fame had sustained me and how it was something that can't float my boat solely. I can't make it the only thing that makes me feel okay. Just another trial
by fire. In the spring of 1987, Perry called a meeting with Neil Schon and John Keane at an isolated spot in Northern California.
John and I were hoping to continue the Red Zone Radio tour, and Steve just basically shut down. He says, look, I'm toast.
I truly was toast. We had not stopped for years. I told him, I just don't think I can do it anymore. I think I just want to stop.
We were kind of confused and hurt. We thought we were a family, and it was like heavy. I'll never forget that.
There was no announcement, no press release, no farewell concert. At the top of their game, Journey simply disappeared. Lost in twilight,
the memories. It was the first time really in my life that I can recall since I was 15 touring where I wasn't touring anymore. I was like, oh, okay, wow, what am I going to do now?
I just let go of the music business. I didn't do nothing. I was really pretty tired. And I had to retreat back to my life because my life had been sort of put on hold.
For the next 7 years, there would be no Journey. The band members moved on to other projects. Neil Schon and Jonathan Keane formed Bad English, and Steve Perry released a second solo album. But none of the music had the enduring magic of Journey. Finally, in 1995, Steve Perry reached out to former bandmate Jonathan Keane. Any way you want it, that's the way you need
it. Any way you want it. I'm like, oh my gosh, what does he want to talk to me about? So I haven't seen this guy and heard from him for eons.
I said, let's get together. I want to talk to you about something. It had been many years, but I got this yearning to be in Journey again. Oh, tight.
But a reunion was not without conditions. Perry wanted to jettison longtime Journey manager Herbie Herbert in favor of Irving Azoff, the man who engineered the Eagles' career and comeback.
Somebody had made the call, so I made the call to Herbie, and I hated it. I hated myself because I wasn't really, you know, it wasn't something that I believed in wholeheartedly. I laid it out, said, I want you to let us go on, and I'm sorry about it.
Herbie agreed to step aside.
So that was my final act of love. And I told him that, too. I said, this is it. This is probably the last thing I can do for you guys.
I really felt that Journey was a unique missed opportunity and one that there were a legion of fans out there desperate to participate in again.
With Azoff in place, the band reunited the classic Journey lineup with Ross Valerie and Steve Smith. And as they began working on the album Trial by Fire, they quickly reignited the magic that had made them megastars.
We sat around the piano, Neil and I and Steve, and we wrote 12 songs, you know, like in 2 weeks.